Well, welcome back to live coverage of the Commonwealth Fencing Championships 2014 from Largs in Scotland. We're getting ready to get back underway for the final two matches here on day four. We're going to have the men's EPI team final between Wales and Singapore coming up for you later this evening. First, we do have the women's Sabre final gold medal match, which is between Singapore and Scotland, the home nation, here at the Inverclyde National Sports Centre, going for another gold. With us in the commentary box today is Jon Salfield and yourself, a Sabreur, Jon. You are, of course, the former coach of Great Britain in the Sabre. What are you hoping to see tonight?
I think it's going to be a really tight match, actually. It's quite hard to call. I'm hoping that we're going to see Scotland coming out fighting really hard and working hard on the piece with good discipline, because to beat the Singapore team, they're going to have to do that. Singapore are technically very correct team, they're good athletes, they move well, they've got a very good tactical coach on the sideline for them as well, and I think if Scotland come out strongly at the beginning, get themselves in the match at the beginning, then it's going to be close, but I think Scotland could pip it.
Of course, you can get in touch with us via Twitter if you will have any questions, particularly about the Sabre, for John. We'll be happy to answer those later on. Get in touch with us using the hashtag CFCLargs or indeed at CFencing 2014. Well, Scotland defeated Wales in a knife-edge match, 45-43, and the efforts of Catherine Kemp, the individual gold medalist, not enough to see the Welsh team through, though they did pick up a bronze against England. Singapore fought off a spirited comeback by the English team to take the match 45-39. There's all sorts of little subplots coming up we're going to see with the two team selections, John, and as you say, strength and depth is so important in the team competitions.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, often, really, team matches often hinge on how well is your number three performing and how well is your number two performing. And it, you know, team order is really, really important. Both teams have, well, certainly Scotland have five fencers to select from. Singapore actually only have the three fencers who are on the team sheet with them. So it's not really a selection issue for them. But for Scotland, really, the selection is going to be an important part of the tactics and what order the fencers go on the piste.
Yeah, we're just having a little look at how Scotland got there. I mean, a fairly comfortable win over India. And as I say, that nail-biter over Wales as well. And that's going to happen in Sabre, isn't it? That we're going to get to the 45 points because the clock's not a factor. It's fast and furious, blood and thunder, as always, with Sabre.
That's absolutely right, yeah. The 3 minutes per fight really does not apply here. It's going to be more seconds than minutes, I would say. So yeah, we're guaranteed to get to 45, nine rounds of five hits, and then three fencers on each team will fence each of the other three fencers on the opposing team. So first team to reach 45 will be the gold medalist and the champion of the Commonwealth Women's Sabre.
Well, we are just about ready to introduce the teams, so let's head on over to our venue announcer.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome your athletes and officials for the Women's Sabre Team Commonwealth Gold Medal Match. Please welcome Scotland and Singapore. For Scotland, Kate Daykin, Jennifer Sancroft, Alice Watson, Michelle Guarino, and Jess Corby. For Singapore, Sharmaine Cheung, Anne Lee, and Ywen Lau. And your international referees are Jolt Kapasvari and Luca Kie. Correction, Andreas Duvis. Please give a big round of applause, make a lot of noise for your gold medal match.
So the introduction of the teams then, I suppose we should try and just explain a little bit about the disparity in team size there, John. I mean, obviously, Scotland introducing five fighters, four of whom, of course, will be used. Jessica Corby is going to be the unused substitute. But Singapore only able to raise a team of three. That's going to be tactically difficult for them. We saw how important tactics were in the men's FA bronze medal match.
That's right. It's a slight disadvantage if one of their fencers has a really bad match and, you know, they can't then substitute, or if there's an injury, in fact, that would be a disaster for them. Scotland obviously have a full complement of five, of which they select four to be on the team sheet. One of those four is on the bench and three will start the match. I don't think it's going to play a big part in this. I think these three girls are the three strongest Singapore fencers, so I think, you know, from their perspective, they'll probably be happy that this would have been their starting lineup anyway. And it's probably worth mentioning, actually, Ywen Lau is only 14 years old, the third Singapore fencer that was introduced.
I suppose she might already have the psychological edge, because she, in fact, beat Kate Daykin of Scotland in the last 32 in the individual event. So, clearly, no slouch, and not just making up the numbers.
No, absolutely. She's obviously a very talented young girl. I would say that, as we saw in the men's epee, not necessarily a reflection in the individual what's going to happen in the team event. Team fencing is a slightly different psychology, as we talked earlier about, not just fencing for yourself, but for your, you know, really clearly for your country and for your teammates. Andreas Duvis from Greece will be refereeing this first fight.
And it's Ywen Lau against Alice Watson. Alice Watson of Scotland on the right-hand side of your screens.
And that's a good parry pass from Alice Watson. Ywen Lau went for the attack to head. Alice Watson blocked and then hit her opponent. So her priority, because she blocked the attack. Exactly the same action. So the Singapore fencer went fast in the middle. Alice Watson was ready, took the blade and riposted to head. Tried the same action again, but this time the technique wasn't as solid and the Singapore fencer managed to hit before the parry met her blade. And now the young fencer from Singapore changed her attack. Alice went for the same block to head, but the Singapore fencer changed, hit on the flank. Good tactical change there. Referee has to decide whether it's a tactical or the other. I agree with that decision. Alice Watson was a bit more, took the initiative a bit more, was quicker off the mark. This time, the Singapore fencer read the situation, guessed Alice was going to attack, and lunged into her preparation. Nice compound attack, very long lunge for such a young, small fencer. Obviously a really good athlete, very flexible. 4-3 lead for Singapore. This is quick fire stuff. Alice again, a little bit quicker, and also her hand was out very early as well, so she got a little bit of time with the feet and the hand. One attack. There's a moment there where the referee was thinking about, did the Singapore fencer just do a tiny little stutter with the feet for attack? No. But he gave it as a compound attack, and I think that was correct. It was still one attack from the Singapore fencer.
Just to remind folks who are watching and just, I suppose, trying to get into fencing and just picking up the sport and maybe watch the epi final earlier on, as we said in Sabre, the clock not really a factor because it is so fast, so we're working up in these blocks of five as we go through the nine rounds.
That's right, yeah. So the target in the first fight is to five, and then you hand on the score to your teammate. So the Singapore fence will come on starting with five. That's An Huimin. Lee will start with five and the opponent starts on four. They're now trying to get to 10. So when one of them reaches 10, they stop and hand on to the next pair until we reach 45 hits. So there are nine rounds of five to reach 45.
And Anne Lee on the left-hand side of the screen, just sorting her mask out. She is the silver medalist in the individual Sabre event. Very impressive as she moved through the round she was as well. So it's going to be a bit of a challenge for Kate Daykin, we think, here.
It is Kate's a really solid team fencer, very good mentality. We have a white light. I think that's on Kate Dakin's side, so there's either a problem with her wire or with her sabre. Technical problem. Referee wants her to change. Wants her to change the equipment so we don't get any more hold-ups or any white lights coming on. So the reason sabre fencing is so fast is that you can hit anything above the waist, so it's a relatively big target. You can hit with any part of the blade and any touch will count. So whereas in foil and épée you have to hit with the point and you have to depress the point with a certain amount of pressure, and in foil it has to stay on the target for a certain period of time, in sabre just the lightest of touches will register a hit. So it's easier to hit your opponent, but that also means obviously it's easier for them to hit you. Decision making is absolutely essential in sabre. You have to have a very cool head under pressure. You have to plan your preparation so when the referee says on guard ready, you actually have got to be ready because the other fence is going to be coming at you. So when he says fence, you have to have your action ready to go. You can't just stand still or wander into the middle of the piece without a plan, otherwise you're in trouble.
Yeah, I mean, it's almost impossible, I'd suggest, to react then to what your opponent's doing. You need to have that, certainly the first move planned out well in advance.
Yeah, so the first action, I think, definitely, you know, the very best fencers do react at incredible speed, and it's not down to reflex so much as, you know, training the motor skills, so you can perceive body language and you can perceive signals from your opponent almost subconsciously. That's an early start for the single defence. It's going to be a yellow card. She's obviously a little bit tense, feeling the pressure of this gold medal match. They went together with the feet, but the Singapore offence's hand was a little bit quicker. And the referee's standing up, isn't it? I think that shows a tiny bit of inconsistency there. I would have said if you gave the previous hit to Singapore, we should have given that one to Scotland. The hand was there for Scotland. It was a nice attack from Kate Wilkin. Scores 5-7. Like FA, you have a few hits deficit. You can make that up very rapidly. Kate shows she's already back within one hit. Again, a nice long attack again. Referee decided there wasn't enough timing for the left and wasn't enough aggressive intent from the right, so he gave nothing. The referee has a very, very big part to play in sabre fencing, particularly in the actions in the middle of the piece. Nice timing. Kate Daykin saw that one coming. Did a lovely tempo into her opponent's attack and got one light. Exactly the same action. She's shortened up her preparation now, so she's in very, very small steps. Gives her a little bit more space so she can see her opponent's intent. And she had the attack there, but I think she just missed. She actually would have had that if her light had come on. I think that would have been hers. Parry pass for the Scottish fencer. Singapore fencer attacked. Kate Daykin blocked it and hit back. 9-8 lead. That's a red. And that is a red for going early. Makes it 10-8 and the match. It's a shame that the fight ended like that, but that just shows how tense the Singapore fencer was. And she also looked a little bit tense in the previous round, to be honest. She went early in the previous round also a couple of times. And I think she's feeling a bit of pressure that maybe she feels a bit like she's having to carry the team. She's the strongest fencer in the team. She won that individual medal. And she's got a bit of responsibility on her shoulders.
Yeah. Just explain again what happened with the yellow card there. I think it's worth sort of pointing out, and obviously this, the first offence is just the warning, and then the red card, it's that particular fight is over.
That's right. Basically, what happens, if you go early before the referee says fence, in between ready and fence, then it's a yellow card offence, so you get a warning with a yellow card. Every subsequent offence is a red card, which is a point to your opponent. So because that was the last point of the match, it meant the match was over. And this was really clamped down on after the Junior World Championships in the last season, when there was a lot of guys trying to run at each other very early, and halfway through the championships there was a kind of meeting with the referees. They decided to just hand out cards immediately for the first defence. So Zsolt Kaposvári steps up to referee, Hungarian referee, regarded as one of the very, very best in the world. You don't often see this guy make mistakes.
That's called the commentator's curse.
Parry riposte with Jon Salfield. She missed her attack, the Scottish fencer. The Singapore fencer attacked, and then a good parry. Nice attack to flank against the left hander. Scotland move 3 hits ahead. So Sharmaine and Ki Cheung struggling with Jon Salfield's timing. Jon Salfield launched the attack first. She missed and then replaced the point. Because she missed her first attempt, the priority pass to the left, So even though both lights came on, that was a hit for Singapore.
Yeah, Jennifer Sancroft actually beat Sharmaine Cheung in the last eight of the individual competition. So you're going to think that Jennifer Sancroft is going to be feeling pretty confident. It was a 15-7 victory in that particular match.
She's comfortable in individual. I think one of the things that she did very well in that fight was she made the Singapore fencer fall short with her attack and then took up the priority. And I think looking at the way the Singapore fencer Cheung is preparing, she's trying to be a little bit more cautious. So she's maybe got a game plan for this fight to try and turn around that individual result.
And she's levelled it up at 12 all.
She has. She just waited for the attack there and took a really nice parry. Attack to the right there. Jennifer Sancroft scores another one for Scotland. Singapore fencer got a bit stuck on the line. She needs to be more mobile up and down the piste. There we go. She fell short with the attack. Sancroft on the attack now. Being very cautious. And a parry crossed again for Singapore. So her game plan is quite clear. If she misses the attack, she's just going to work hard on the piste, use all 14 metres that she has to work with, and then take a parry on the last action. So Sancroft needs to change her attack a little bit, maybe be more positive, put more pressure back on to Cheung.
Just another little technical problem with a white light flashing on and off.
Just a bit of a loose connection in the Sabre somewhere. Electrical connection. Singapore fencers coming forward with their eyes open, just kind of watching what's happening, but not taking any action, just waiting. And then Sancroft launched a really good lunge on preparation. Cheung on the attack. Oh, nice parry cross for Sancroft. It's called a parry of second. So the Singapore fencer came into the low line, into the flank, and then Jennifer Sancroft just turned her sabre pointing downwards into second position, blocked the blade and hit back at her opponent. Good use of the piste there. She worked very hard in defence. As I said earlier on, they're going to have to work hard on the piste, have good discipline, because the Singapore fencers are good athletes and very patient.
You were talking earlier as well about being able to read your opponent, about the things that are going to happen. I just wonder how you either train for that or how you coach your
good attack on preparation from Lau. She worked hard going back. Daykin just closed distance a bit too much. Nice parry cross from Kate Daykin. Lau committed early. Daykin saw it and took parry cross. And she's just done exactly what she did in the previous fight, Kate Daykin. She's now shortened up her first couple of steps, so she has a bit more space and time to see her opponent's intention.
We're talking about very small margins. We're talking about shortening the steps. You know, we're not talking about huge distances along the piste here.
That's right. I mean, they start 4 metres apart, so if you do two big steps, it has a really big impact on the distance compared to two small steps. And there again, you saw Daykin doing very short, sharp steps, waiting for opponent to commit and then taking the blade out of the way and hitting. Lau has now changed her attack, so she's attacking to chest. Daykin was blocking out to her right-hand side, and Lau attacked to the fence's left. Harsh, but fair, I would say, on that decision. Ooh, a little bit lucky. Singapore fencer Lau missed her attack, had a second stab before Kate Daykin could get her riposte on. Nice flick to the wrist. Really well read by Kate Daykin there. She kept good composure. She read the fight well. Three-hit cushion for Scotland after four rounds.
But as we know in Sabre, it's not really enough. Three hits and 15 hits could not be enough.
Absolutely. Three hits is nothing really. I remember a very experienced Sabre fencer telling me when I was a lad and I was losing a fight 8-4, he said 8-4 down in Sabre is a platform for victory. A small like platform, admittedly.
The sage words of the experienced there.
That's right. So yeah, 2017 is, you know, it's not a convincing lead. It is a lead, obviously, and that's where you want to be. But really, if the match is a close match, which this one looks like it's going to be, then the match truly starts in those last three fights, where your number three takes on their number three, and your number two takes on their number two, and then finally, hopefully, your number one takes on their number one, and that's when it really starts to kick off. And then it's who's going to keep their head under pressure and stick with their game plan. Scotsman went on the attack, but again, Singapore have obviously got this plan to use the end of the piece, make the fencers, the opponents work hard, and then take parry poste on the last action. So Cheung did this in her previous fight very well. Score is 20-18. That it had just gone up incorrectly at first. Attacked Alice Watson. Straight off the line, attacked her flank. Cheung thought she should have got a light up. So she wants to just test and make sure her kit's working. Cheung was waiting in the middle again to see her opponent's intention and left it too late. Alice Watson with a strong lunge. They both went in and out, and then they both attacked together, simultaneous, so no score. Unlike Epe, if you hit simultaneously, no point is given. We have another small technical hit.
Yeah, I was going to say that must be a little distracting because we've had the flashing white lights going on and off. So we're just going to have a quick change of equipment here. I think a new weapon being brought out.
Yeah. I think the referee is deciding whether it's a body wire or saber problem. It looks like it's the body wire. This is the wire that connects your saber to the whole scoring system. So it goes into the saber, up your sleeve, out your back, and then plugs into a cable, which is a part of a spring-loaded reel. And then that plugs into the scoring system. It's a pretty elaborate mechanical system.
I suppose there's not really much of a way around it other than, you know, investing in technology and trying to find new ways of making it as stable as possible.
Yeah, I mean, at the top level, actually, it is now wireless. So it's all done with wireless systems. There have been a few hitches with that in the consistency of the scoring. So the FIA has just got a competition running at the moment to design a new wireless system, which they're hoping to release, I think, for next year. So yeah, the very top level, kind of Grand Prix and World Championships, European Championships, that kind of thing, it's now a wireless system. It doesn't actually get rid of the white lights, you have different problems, but it looks a bit prettier. So whilst they're having a change of kit, scores 22-20 to Scotland. Alice Watson's on the piste.
Would you think Alice would be, she allowed to go and have a quick chat with the coach, quick chat with the teammates?
Technically no, but actually yes, is the honest answer. I mean, if you look at World Cup level, the coach's not supposed to give any advice during the fight other than in the 1 minute breaks individually or in between fights in the team event. However, every coach at international level breaks that rule and everyone turns a blind eye. It's not like tennis where it's very much frowned upon. It's very much an accepted part of the game. And it ranges from yelling very sensible things to yelling abuse. So it can be sometimes helpful and actually it can be if it's the wrong kind of coaching support.
Back underway then in round five of this particular gold medal match. And Scotland pushing out at just a 3-point lead now, 23-20. Push the 45, remember.
Singapore fencer just struggling for consistency. When she's worked hard on the piece, she's had more success. Alice has been very strong in the middle of the piece. Oh, that's a nice parry cross from Watson. Singapore fencer pushed the attack all the way to the end, but Alice Watson was ready, took a good parry, and riposte for a 4-hit lead. Watson on the attack, just falls short. It's an important hit now for Singapore, I think. They don't want to have a 5-hit gap, and that's a good line. Alice Watson extended her arm out in what's called a line position, and the Singapore fencer just walked straight onto that point. One light for Scotland, and a 5-hit cushion. This is now a really, really important fight for Singapore. If Scotland maintain this lead, that could be a decisive match. If Singapore pull back a few hits, we're still kind of on a knife edge, really.
Yeah, I suppose we're round to, I suppose, the big guns of each team, Jennifer Sancroft and Anne Lee, if you go by the individual tournament results as well. So it'll be interesting to see what happens here if Jen Sancroft just tries to defend this lead or wants to extend it a little further for our teammates.
Yes, a lot of noise from the Singapore support in the crowd is really great to hear, trying to compete with the Scottish vocal support. We'll see if Anne Lee's settled down because she did seem to feel a bit of pressure at the beginning of this match. She's very tense and going early, if you remember, in her first fight. So this is quite an important fight for her. If she keeps composure, she can pull Singapore back. If Jen Sancroft keeps hers, could be a convincing match. Both individual medalists, yeah.
We've talked a little this week about varying styles from country to country, and you're saying that the fighters from Singapore tend to be very spot-on technically.
Yeah, absolutely. They've got a fantastic coach. Andras Deci is a Hungarian coach, was an excellent fencer himself. His brother was a World Championship medalist, very experienced coach, and Hungarian technique is kind of the classic sabre technique, and they're very much focused on getting those basics perfect. So he's been coaching there for a while now, and we've seen a massive improvement from the young ages all the way through to senior level. So I think they're a team for the future. I'm just looking at how young some of their fences are as well. Yeah,
14 years old, of course, Lau, who's taking part in this particular match. Valuable as well, though, I think, for the likes of Jennifer Sancroft to face opponents she won't be facing week in, week out.
That's right. I think this is one of the great things about this event. It gives exposure to the British fencers to other international styles. Jen Sancroft's got a moderate amount of World Cup experience, senior World Cup experience for Great Britain. Alice Watson has quite a lot of experience at senior World Cup level. So they do understand the different styles of different nations. Annelie's pulled back a couple of hits already. That was a better attack. Then Jen Sancroft just changed her preparation, was a little bit sharper, more aggressive on the first step. Put her opponent immediately under pressure, put her on the back foot, and managed to finish her attack. Fences have to start behind the gold line on the piece. And this time she changed, Jen Sancroft changed her parry post, so attack from the Singapore fencer, anticipating a quick attack from the Scottish fencer, but she was wrong and the Scottish fencer outwitted her with a parry post. Very nice stop cut under the wrist. So as Anne Lee was waiting to finish her attack, just holding up her attack, Jen Sancroft managed to get her blade out and cut underneath the wrist.
Yeah, just stopping the momentum ever so slightly of the Singapore fighter.
That's right. That's one back. Very rapid attack from the word fence by the referee. Probably noticed all the referees in French, sort of a traditional language of fencing. So the gap's back to three. And he's starting to look a little bit more relaxed as she starts to land those attacks. Just falls short there. That was a soft hit, really, from the Singapore fencer. She missed her attack. She went back just a couple of steps, then counter-attacked. That was a bit of loss of discipline.
You talked earlier about the importance of the referees as well, and it must be difficult when one or two decisions go against you. You start showing your frustration, shall we say.
That's right, and I think also you can amplify that in your mind and kind of exaggerate the situation. Obviously, as a fencer and as a coach, great hit on preparation there by Jen Sancroft.
Yeah, Anne Lee is pretty furious with herself there.
Yeah.
Not too happy. Big roars from the Scots in the crowd, though.
I think as a fencer and a coach, you're always going to see 50-50 hits as 60-40 in your favour. I think that's just kind of human nature. So it's quite easy to lose the plot a little bit and focus too much on what the referee's doing and not enough on what you're doing as a fencer. And there is sort of grey area in sabre fencing, that kind of middle of the piece where both fencers are coming forward. Some referees slightly favour the fencer who's going quicker. Some referees slightly favour the fencer who's got a more correct hand position. So you have to really see what your referee's giving. It's a little bit like in rugby when some referees will be harsher on certain rules than others. And you have to kind of work out what your referee's doing in fence like that. If you try and change the referee's mind, you're going down the wrong path, unfortunately. Not that I haven't tried it myself in the past, but
who hasn't, I would suggest. So moving into the seventh round of this match, this gold medal match here at the Commonwealth Fencing Championships 2014.
And there's a good example of Jolt Kapaspari there. Wants the fencers to have a correct hand position, technique. He's a Hungarian, so he's used to seeing really classic technique back home. Score is... Has the score gone up correctly? No, it hasn't. That's correct now. 30-27. Yeah, it's a nice hit from the single fencer. She read that well. Made Kate Daykin fall short and then really aggressive finish on her attack.
And for the end of this round, the target is 35.
Kate Aiken came forward, looked for the blade, tried to hit the blade, and then that lost her the priority, so the Singapore fencer took up the attack. There's parry post from Kate Aiken. She's pulled that hit out a few times in this match. And again, just as we've seen in previous fights, Cheung came forward and just hesitated in the middle and just gave a little bit of time to her opponent to lunge into the preparation. She's taking a bit too long to decide. Kate Daykin on the attack, three hit cushion, and she lands the attack. Extends it out to four hits. This could just be starting to move away from Singapore now. Again, that same action where Cheung comes into the middle, does one step too many and hesitates, and that gives the tempo to her opponent to just score with a really strong lunge.
She seems to have mixed it up very, very well in this particular set. Kate Daykin.
She has, yes. She started badly in this leg and then really changed very quickly, adapted very well, and that's a lovely attack and preparation. So at the beginning, I think she was a bit tense and was chasing the fight, and then just settled down after the first couple of hits and put in a really strong last section of that fight to hand over a 5-hit lead. Great performance. She's only 18 years old as well, very young fencer, still in the British junior squad, so I've seen her competing quite a lot at junior World Cup level, and really promising fencer.
And we're just hearing that there will be a substitution for Scotland coming up, and it will be Michelle Guarino coming in place of Jennifer Sancroft.
Interesting substitution. So Michelle Guarino's on. She has a 5-hit cushion to defend against the 14-year-old Ywen Lau, who must be feeling a bit of pressure at such a young age.
But Scotland have maintained that 5-point lead rather over the last three rounds. And we are entering crunch time, perhaps. The last couple of rounds, you've said, is very important in these Team Sabre competitions.
It's really do or die now for Singapore. They need to pull back. They can't hand over a big deficit for the last fight, I don't think. Alice Watson closed out very, very well in the previous round against Wales in a tense match. Lau is going off the mark much faster than Michelle Guarino, and she's getting the attack given to her by the referee, and I think absolutely correctly. So Michelle Guarino a little bit sharper that time, got a simultaneous. Nice power riposte. The young fencer Lau has already scored 3-1.
It's maybe just settled the nerves a little of Guarino.
Simultaneous, they both jumped in and out, trying to make the other one fall short. Both had the same idea and then hit together, so no score. Tiny bit more positive from the Singapore fencer than the Scottish fencer, but not enough for the referee to be convinced that it was her attack. Now Singapore go on the defence, she finds the blade. I thought there was a blade contact from the Singapore fencer there, but obviously not enough to convince the ref. And she's gone back to her attacking game, which was more successful at the start of the fight. Attack left. Absolutely, Singapore fences hit. Michelle Guarino was just waiting to see what was happening and just handed the initiative over. Now, long attack from Singapore. And there it is, landed. This could turn out to be a bad tactical decision on the substitution.
Yeah, a little surprised it was Jennifer Sancroft taken out, do you think?
Yeah, it's a tough call to make. I mean, it's, you know, coach is always going to get blamed if it goes wrong, and the fencers are always going to get the credit if it goes right. So as a coach, I know how that feels. You know, we've all made those decisions based on good evidence.
And that levels it up at 37 points all.
Shall Guarino on the attack? And it is attacked. Just a little bit of loss of discipline by Lau. I mean, not surprising, a 14-year-old fencer in this situation. She's showing a lot of maturity. But she should have just carried on working down the piece, not counter-attacked. This is really tense now. Attack for Lau. Michelle Guarino found the blade. So she took priority back by doing a beat on the blade.
That could be crucial, that hit.
It could be. Guarino and Scotland go into the last fight with a 3-hit cushion. That could have been a lot worse, to be honest.
There was a couple of little wobbly moments from Michelle Guarino in there, I think.
Yeah.
But she did very well to come back into it. Lau, perhaps, feeling the pressure, as you say, John, just 14 years old and in a gold medal match. But now we do have Anne Lee, who's going to be fighting in this last round
with Alice Watson.
The target 45, and 45 points will get a gold medal here at the Commonwealth Fencing Championships.
I think at the start of the match, Scotland would have settled for a three-hit cushion in the last fight. So I think Ben Hanley, their coach, will be able to very happily justify that substitution, despite my doubts earlier on. So it's all down to these two fencers for the gold medal. And it's now about who's going to keep their calm and have the right game plan. And just do this to referee the last leg of this match. You can hear a pin drop. Arrow cross for Lee to start the fight off. Watson went on the attack. And Lee stepped back, took the blade and riposted. Harsh decision, but I think correct. She just had a little stutter in the attack and just had a little look what Watson was doing, and Watson just chose that moment to take up the priority.
Doesn't want to call that.
Both went for it, both together. Ooh, very good tactical decision from Watson. She went in and out, made her opponent stop. But then, as she attacked, Andy pulled out a really nice parry post. For me, Alice Watson stops attack for the Singapore fencer, and that's what the referee's given.
It has suddenly got very, very tense in here at 41 points to 40 in this gold medal match.
Yes, I think that's right from Andreas Duvis. They both did the same preparation, they both stepped forward, but Alice Watson was waiting with her hand to see what was happening, and Lee launched her attack more positively, 41 all. Attack for Lee, can she hold it? Can Watson take it? Parry cross for Alice Watson. Right at the back of the piece. Really good patience from the Scottish fencer, good discipline. That's what they need to do, these guys. They need to use every inch of the piece against Singapore. Attack for Alice Watson now. One hit lead. But on her preparation, Anne Lee launched a really good straight arm counter-attack to pull back level. It is now really on a knife edge. Referee decided not to yellow card that one, which could be actually a very important decision. Exactly the same decision that Andreas Stevens has given in the last three times this has happened. He saw the stutter in the footwork on the attack, so the attack stopped, and then the attack was taken up by the other side, so hit for Alice Watson. Very harsh, but absolutely correct. Once you have that attack, you cannot stop. You have to keep it rolling. Yeah, Alice Watson took the attack.
Big cheer from the Scottish section of support.
For me, actually, her first one missed, and she had a second stab at it and got one light. Very close to that goal now. Harry Boston. Anne Lee attacked ahead, Watson was ready for it, took a really good camp parry post and took the gold medal. Held her nerve in the end. Lee came back to pull it level at 42 all. With some very, very strong footwork, good movement, good tactics, but Alice Watson held it together, kept her head, pulled out a really nice parry post on the last hit. Great win for Scotland.
Women's Sabre team, gold medalists, Scotland!
That is yet another gold medal for Scotland at these championships. That's the third in 2 days.
Commonwealth silver medalists, Singapore!
And a warm round of applause from the audience as well for Singapore, who pick up yet another medal themselves. And given that there are only three in the Sabre team, they've done exceptionally well going through every fight, the three girls there.
They have done well, and they're a young team as well, working really hard back home in Singapore with a great setup. They've got good coaches out there working, they've got good facilities and good funding, and you know they are going to be back, and I think they're going to be back stronger next time.
It's been a fantastic couple of days for Scottish fencing, and their targets I think were six individual medals and three team medals, and they've already reached six individual and two team, including three gold. So you know it's going to be a big boost for Scottish fencing, not just hosting the event here, but having success at it as well. It's always important when you have success at your own home games.
Absolutely. Home turf is obviously a great thing, but it can also be a big pressure. And obviously the guys have dealt really well with that pressure of being at home and the home crowd wanting medals and wanting them to win. And, you know, sometimes that extra adrenaline can push you over the edge and make you make bad decisions, not good ones. But they've really dealt with it very well. I would be controversial and say three team medals was a conservative target. I would have said, I would have said maybe four or five should have been the target. You would look at that and see which events they expect not to medal in. But I still think their performances exceeded expectation, and I think they will go on and win more medals over the next 2 days as well. So, you know, it's been a really, really good performance. And I think, obviously, I would say, you know, the highlight for me from the Scotland perspective is Jamie Fitzgerald's semi-final yesterday, and then going on to win the final in fantastic style.
Overall, the games we've had throughout the UK, whether it was London 2012 or whether it was Glasgow 2014, obviously we had in the summer, so much talk about legacy and what it means to have a successful game, successful teams, as we're just seeing the Scotland team kind of getting together for a big group hug there. And it's converting that. It's obviously a lot of the work you do is getting the youngsters in through the door and showing them how to take fencing on and develop it as a sport that they'll keep with them.
That's right. I think it's really important for Scottish fencing that they use this as a springboard to the future, not just as a combination, obviously, of lots of work and trying to get the event here and put on a fantastic event. But this should be the start of something rather than the end of something. And, you know, I'm very much of the opinion although there was a lot of talk around legacy with London 2012, I actually believe we still did not make the most of, certainly for our sport, what we could have done for fencing out of 2012. And I think it's important for Scotland that they go on and use their success at this competition, which is very significant, to be a springboard to the future.
I mean, does being able to watch, obviously, our broadcasts here, watching them live, whether that's, you know, wherever it might be, does it help bring the youngsters in? Does it help just get that sport known a little bit wider?
I think the key is that you get that initial surge of interest and you get that initial kind of uptake, but then the onus is on the federation and on the clubs and on the coaches to make sure they maintain that and they snowball it. It's very easy to think, oh, we've solved all our problems, we've now got new people coming through the door. But then you need, every year, you need the next generation to come in. And you're not going to have the Commonwealth here every year, so you need to make sure that this is a springboard to start that effect. Because if you expect people to walk in the door after this, you may be right, but then next year they're not going to, and the year after they're not going to. So you have to keep it rolling.
Pretty positive.